Berks County Tennis Talk on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Tennis Association.
Good evening, tennis enthusiasts, and welcome to another exciting edition of Berks County Tennis Talk here on BCTV. I am your host, Ryan Knarr, here with my co-host, Hutch, Don Hutchinson. Hutch, how you doing tonight?
Doing really good tonight. Great to see you. Glad to be back.
Yeah, a little hiatus from the fall season, but
that's
we're
exactly
back.
Right.
And really excited to have you here for the next 30 minutes here on Berks County Tennis Talk. Gonna talk a little bit about a couple things, Hutch, tonight. First thing, it is our last show of the year, last show of the decade. So,
wow.
A lot of tennis played between 2010 and 2019. We're gonna look at the top 10 men and the top 10 women at the ATP professional level over the last 10 years as decided by the sports writers of Tennis Magazine.
Sounds good to me. Let's fire away and I'll give you my opinion on a couple of people there.
Absolutely. From there, we're also gonna recap, Hutch, the seasons or the year that was in high school tennis locally. Some teams making state finals, teams, the county titles, two state champion, a doubles team. So we're going to recap that on the boys and the girls side. And then also look at some of our local college players, where they're playing through college tennis here in Berks County and beyond.
Yeah, we had a good season. A lot of college kids playing that were high school, Berks High School kids that have moved on playing some good college tennis. Mm-hmm. And we had some real good success in districts and states this year.
Yep, absolutely.
So, nice time to talk about the kids at the end of the year.
Absolutely. Going to hand out the telephone number, 610-378-0426. Go ahead, give us a call. Any thoughts, comments on our top 10 pro players of the decade in the men's or women's, high school tennis, college tennis. Love to hear from you. With that, Hutch, let's get our top 10 men, and I think, you know, the top three are pretty obvious of who they will be, but in what particular order is always interesting. But looking at number 10 on the men's side, you have, I feel, one of the best, and again, we'll keep it short for each of the players, but probably one of the best clay court players other than Nadal currently and in the last 10 years, and that's Dominic Thiem from Austria.
Yeah, Thiem has, to me, just an incredible velocity, especially off his backhand. Quick, athletic, and generates all kinds of pace and spin and all kinds of stuff. Yeah, he's just unbelievable.
And you know, I've heard people refer to this, and I think they're right. They say he doesn't have a backhand. He has two forehands. Right, he can hit both sides. It's equal, and he can hit the same power and just unbelievable on both sides.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen a topspin backhand with so much pace generated from somebody ever, from anybody, especially one-handed. He's a one-hander, right?
Yep, and he
crushes it.
And the clay, you know, he's certainly, other than Nadal, arguably the second-best clay court player of this decade. Yeah. You know, obviously other than the great Rafa Nadal.
Yeah, pretty impressive with pace.
Number 9, Juan Martín Del Potro. And here's a guy, Hutch, you know, ravaged with injuries more at the end of this decade, but I mean, when he's healthy, he's a load.
When he's healthy, he's a beast. He is the beast. He has probably the biggest forehand I've ever seen.
Atomic. I use that very sparingly, but an atomic forehand.
6'6". And well over 200, and just a beast with the forehand. If he's hitting his forehand on balance, there's nobody who can get it back.
And I always said from back in the this is when before he won his first major. I remember one of our great teaching pros in this area, Ricardo Saad, said we have a secret weapon in Argentina. He's 6'6", 200 pounds. He said he can beat Federer, Nadal, and I looked at Ricardo. I thought, no way. And the guy comes out and beats Federer and ends his streak of 5 straight U.S. Open. So Ricardo was definitely right on him. But again, great player, just has been ravaged the last couple of years with some injuries.
Injury riddled. That wrist injury, a couple other. But but when you're that big and you pound yourself on the courts that much, I mean, you're going to get injured.
Absolutely.
Unfortunately, because what a talent.
Yep. Next guy on the list, number 8, Tomáš Berdych. And Berdych just retired this year, but again, a stellar top 10 player, made a Wimbledon final, but he was always one of those guys finishing top 10 in the world, consistent. Wasn't one of the top 2 or 3 guys, but he was a consistent player.
No, I don't think ever won a Grand Slam.
Mm-hmm.
I've watched him play in person a couple times, has Godzilla thighs. The dude is 6'5". His thighs are huge. Always wears his shorts below his thighs so you don't see how big they are. They're huge.
Yeah.
But and never won a Grand Slam. Yep. Never made it probably top better than top five.
Yep, that was it.
But was an awesome player, a tough out for everybody. You're
he
probably
could, gonna, any given day he could beat any of the best.
Yeah, and just good serve, good mm-hmm. everything,
yep.
And a big man. I mean, yep. I had a chance to sit next to his girlfriend of the match, outer court U.S. Open, and it was a good time.
Nice. Number seven, another model of consistency. Never won a major, but he did go to, and this is one of the more impressive streaks, 10 consecutive major quarterfinals. Another Spaniard, probably the second best Spaniard of this decade other than Rafa Nadal, and that's David Ferrer.
Yeah, Ferrer the bulldog.
Mm-hmm.
He's like a little bulldog. One of my friends bumped into him at the U.S. Open. It's funny. As he plays tennis, his head is always down. He's always concentrating on the ball, always down. And my friend happened to be walking out there. He walked right into him because his head was down.
Yep.
Boom! Ferrer hit him right in the chest. He's only about like 5'6", 7'8".
Not a big guy.
No, not a big guy. Oh, but
yeah.
Run
yeah.
And try to work a point.
Yeah.
Woohoo!
Yeah.
Wow.
So... Again, and again, another guy just retired here, end of the decade with Tomas Berdych. So two guys that you know had a great run for a number of years. Number six, we have the Croatian Marin Cilic, a one-time major winner, 2014 U.S. Open champion. Also made two more finals, made a Wimbledon final, and also an Australian final in 2018. Again, another towering 6'6" player.
And another huge guy had an opportunity this year to be at the US Open practice courts and watch him practice. Very impressed on what he does, practice courts. Very impressed on what he does out on the regular courts.
Mm-hmm.
He might be getting a little bit old for tennis age.
Still hits the...
To be out there and beating the big guys he's beaten in the mm-hmm. past. I mean, he's maybe just a little past his prime, but boy, is he tough. Tough out.
Absolutely.
Does everything well when his serve is on. He's unbelievable.
Yep. Number five, and again, you talk about a late bloomer in his career, somebody that's come and been right there and pushed and beaten a number of beaten the big three, and that's Stan the Man, Stan Wawrinka.
Stan the Man, Stasiak, the old wrestler. But
mm-hmm.
And literally... Wawrinka has got a chest almost about the size of Stan the Man from wrestling.
Yeah.
I mean, he is so big and strong, and he wields that big one-handed backhand. And on any given day, because of his strength and power, he can power through the better guys.
On all surfaces.
On all surfaces. Makes no difference. That backhand, he turns incredible. And you look at the size of his chest.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of that pace from upper body in here. Incredible guy, great talent. A little spat there at one time with Federer, but then they got back together to play Davis Cup doubles together.
He has a Davis Cup championship.
Yeah.
He has a U.S. Open. He has a French Open.
French, unbelievable.
One year Nadal was injured. He stepped up and won that. And he also has an Australian Open. So the lone, you know, to get the Grand Slam title, to get all four of them, he's missing Wimbledon. But, you know, just an outstanding. And he didn't win any of them until he was 29 or 30. Years old,
and a bigger guy because of that body probably going to break down a little bit.
Yep.
I mean, he powers through balls. He's mm-hmm. not pretty to watch. He's just a power player that is
absolutely
unbelievable.
Number four. Now we get to the big four, and the fourth member of that, Andy Murray, the Brit, bringing home the first Wimbledon title in 2012. Since actually it was 2013, since Fred Perry in 36. So won a U.S. Open. Won a gold medal at the Olympics, and then finally made it back over the hump and won two Wimbledons. And he won a Davis Cup, too, so a very accomplished, you know, one of the all-time greats.
Yeah, he is one of the all-time greats, just recovering now from a hip injury, right? And probably, again, a bigger body, a bigger guy, 6'3", all the pounding after the years takes a little, you know, tough on the body, just mm-hmm. tough on the body. But hit everything. Probably a great returner, great getter of the ball.
Great finesse, touch.
Yeah, defensive player, mm-hmm. wonderful defensive player. And when he's on, really tough. Hates to give up on any point.
Mm-hmm.
And probably not the most smiley of players when he's on the court.
Right.
Yeah. He's always growling out there.
So now you get to your top three, and it's pretty essential. You know who they're going to be, you know, between them. You just don't know in what order, but you have Roger Federer, you have Djokovic, you have Nadal, you have Djokovic, Nadal, Federer. How do you put them in order? And that's the question. And they did it here, and I'll give you their list, and I'll give you a reaction. So at number three, they went Roger Federer, who's arguably the greatest player of all time. a lot of success, especially from 2003 through 2010, had that big gap of a window of 4 years where he threw, or 3 or 4 years where he didn't win a major. Now he's consistently won, you know, averaged maybe one a year here for the last couple. Thoughts on Federer being number three?
Yeah, for me, it's awfully tough to put the guy who owns the greatest number of Grand Slam titles at number three.
Yeah.
Maybe in a couple of years, if he's not the top guy, then put him down.
Yeah.
But, and he's on the probably the backside of his career right now, but he's still going still going great at 38.
Yep.
Still can win majors.
Mm-hmm.
And probably the prettiest player ever.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you ever want to watch any stroke on video, perfect stroke.
He's the guy.
He's the guy.
Yep.
Perfect volley, perfect serve, perfect forehand, perfect setup.
Movement, everything.
Everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. His footwork probably better than anybody else, and the reason he is around so long is because there's very little wear and tear in the body from
right.
such great footwork and being light on his feet,
yep.
as opposed to like a Nadal who's heavy,
yep.
or Roenke heavy on the feet.
And speaking of Nadal, he comes in at number two. So thoughts on Nadal at two, and what does that leave? That leaves Djokovic as number one.
And Nadal's number two
yes.
in the world as right. far as Grand Slam titles. How can you put, I can understand him at two behind Federer.
And the reason that they did it with tennis.com and what they looked at years at number one, most majors accrued in the decade. Now, if you look at the actual decade, Djokovic had the most majors. He won 15 of his 16 majors in this decade.
In the decade.
Which was the most of most majors in the decade.
So that's
this is not of all time. This is of the decade.
Of the decade. Oh, right. Okay, and I guess I can see that if you're taking a look at stats like that. And you know, head-to-head, I don't know what those guys are. I would think that they're very close.
And Djokovic has a head-to-head on hard, on clay. It's Nadal by a landslide.
But, yeah.
but you take the clay out, and it's Djokovic on the
and
other
then it gets
two
back
surfaces.
And you've got Djokovic again, who's incredibly fit, incredibly lanky, and you watch him stretch for balls and the splits he does. It's unbelievable. He's very light. He's 6'3", and I think it's 163 pounds.
So he moves like a gazelle, yeah.
He does, and he does not much wear and tear because he's so light. Where you've got Nadal, he's got the
yep.
muscle, and he's got the grit.
Right.
And he's like an animal out there. And so again, some injuries popping with Nadal, not mm-hmm. so much with Djokovic.
And just a couple stats here before we move on from the list, but Djokovic became the first player ever to win all 9 Masters tournaments. He's won them all.
I did see that.
He has 7 Australian Open crowns, 6 of them in this decade, and he also finished number one 5 times this decade, so half of the years he finished as the year-end number one. Split that with Nadal as 3 and Federer 2. This decade, I can see where they've come to that. To me, it's an argument between Nadal and Djokovic, I think. It's, you know, Nadal has ridiculous stats on clay. 12 Barcelona titles, 11 Monte Carlo titles, French Open, the guy could win it 20 times by the time he's done. But an interesting list altogether.
It's a cool list, and I've heard a bunch of the pros say, and some of the real well-known guys as far as knowing tennis well, that they picked Djokovic to maybe pass both Nadal mm-hmm. and Federer in yep. the list eventually.
Yeah.
Not there yet. And I could see that.
I don't. I see it, but I don't. I think Nadal, because you got to see when these guys get past 35, it's going to be a tough out to get like a Federer. He might get one here, one there. He's always a threat, but to get over that hump, now in a couple of years, he might be off the table. It might just be Nadal and Djokovic. I just see Nadal getting one at 34 and 35 and 36 and 37 at the French. So you know he's going to get
yeah.
3 or 4. In my opinion, he plays till 2024 because the Olympics are in Paris and they're going to be played at Roland Garros.
That's pretty
He'll
cool.
be 38, 39. It's a 2 out of 3 set match on clay. He's game on that any day of the week.
And can he keep his body in shape?
That's the key.
Is he healthy? Is he healthy enough
yeah.
to do that? And,
yep.
and clay, if you play it on clay, is a lot easier on the body than mm-hmm. playing on hard courts. A
yep.
lot easier, especially my age.
Yep.
But it is. So, yeah, great discussion.
Yeah.
You know, three great guys.
Yeah.
And they've probably pushed each other to the heights that they've all raised each other to. Can you imagine if there was only one of those guys around the last decade?
Right.
How many majors would he have won? Or maybe he wouldn't have gotten up there
right.
because he wasn't pushed.
Yeah.
So great discussion.
Yeah,
great
absolutely.
Guys for tennis. Wonderful guys.
Hutch, you want to move on? We'll look at some of the high school, let's call it the high school year in review, looking at the guys, the girls.
We did have a cool year.
Yeah, good year in high school tennis.
And we'll congratulate Ryan. Had a great year at Conrad Weiser. The guys finished in the finals of the counties, which was pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm.
The girls won the counties for the first time. Really awesome.
Yep.
Both the other finals for Y Missing. Y Missing guys beat your guys and Y Missing girls.
It's been Weiser and Wyo for the last 3 years.
I know.
Boys and girls back and forth. And we finally got one. So.
Well, congratulations on that.
Thank you.
That's awesome. And congratulations to Mike Gomber, too. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's had a bunch of good years and another good one this year.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you watch the teams as they go to districts, very interesting in the girls this year. We had Hamburg knock off Weil for the first time,
mm-hmm.
which is really good.
Bill Tritt called it the win of his career.
That's exactly right. Yeah, Gomber doesn't like that one. Mike, you have many. And then we had you guys that made it to the finals.
Yep.
Right? Pequa Valley.
Lost to, the boys. The boys made the state final.
Right.
And our girls made the district final against Mannheim Township.
So, against Mannheim, and Mannheim did pretty good. Mannheim's always
they're the 21-time state, 21-time district champions. So that's the most all time, even more than Wyo. So it's pretty impressive. They're in AAA.
And then you guys had your first state win, I think, this year.
Misprint in the paper, second state win, for the girls. We won last year, made the quarters 2 years in a row. The guys, we had our first state win, third state wins when we made the final. So it was a magical run for the guys to not even win a district match before this year, let alone get through the district tournament and then get into states and
get
make
to
a
the
state
states.
Final.
And that was Pequa Valley.
And that was when Pequa, who, two teams that never won a district match before this year, ended up meeting in the state final, which is just absolutely, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's kind of a magical year, and congratulations to you and to Conrad Weiser. That's a great run.
Yeah.
And hopefully you can have some more of them.
And that's the sustainability.
It's Berks County tennis that we love.
Absolutely.
And then when we push it a little farther, mm-hmm. we talk about the two kids from, the doubles team for Conrad Weiser and the doubles team from Wild, the boys' doubles team. And mention the names and how they got to the county finals here, the district finals, and the state finals, the same four guys.
You know, I'm sure you see this a little bit in Philly or Pittsburgh a lot because just the depth of what they have in those places that you see a team meet in a county, a district, and a state final. But if it's not the first time, it's probably one of the few that we've had, whether it's a singles or doubles, a doubles team with James Podiker and Will Schreck.
Schreck, right.
And another doubles team of Nick Bellassi and Jack Fitzpatrick play each other in a county final. A district final and the state
and
final,
the state
which
final.
Is neat to see that kind of dominance at each level.
And it's great to see it coming out of Berks County. I mean, so we've got four kids at county finals. Well, obviously you're going to have them out of Berks. District final, mm-hmm. not so much. And state final, I mean, that's awesome.
And a great year for James, too. Won his maiden singles county title, had a nice year doing that. Berks Player of the Year.
Yep.
We had.
And then Panko.
Yep.
And had a great year.
Yep.
Another county title. She was successful in districts. Did she win a match or two in districts?
She three-time county player of the year, three-time county champion.
Yep.
Was the top seed in districts, got upset in the quarters.
The quarters,
at Hershey, but came back, made a district final in dubs.
Nice.
And a state quarter, so.
She had another really good year.
Yeah.
Another really good year.
And you put those stats together and you look at that and, you look at something we're working on for, down the road here, maybe next show, which will be in January, which is top 10 players of the decade in Berks for the high school level. And she's right up there because of the stats. I mean, three-time player of the year.
She's up there.
Yeah. She's up in that top five somewhere.
And James has got to be there someplace. Yeah, he's got a
state title, a state final. He made the state final the year before that in doubles.
State
and
final,
a county
a state title.
And a district title, so in doubles. So
he's got a bunch.
Yeah, so really cool.
Yeah, that's really cool. And then if we want to take it a little farther and kind of push what our Berks County kids have been doing in college,
mm-hmm.
Now, we have a nice run here, and again, I'm the Alvernia men's coach, and I'll run through some of the Alvernia kids who are from Berks County. Excuse the glasses. You'll have this. So we've got Mike Brophy, Reed Hoff. We've got Noah Hermody, Derek Bolts, and Dylan Bolts. So we've got some Hamburg kids. We've got
Brandywine.
We've got a Mifflin kid. We've got a Wilson kid.
Yep.
Pretty cool. And then we have Laura Coveley from Wilson in the
Berks
girls.
Berks Catholic.
Yeah, that's right.
And Ariana Trapinski from Mifflin.
Yep. And then we, Albright, unfortunately, the guys aren't doing too well over there, but Mara Trefoy.
Number one player.
Number one player over at Albright. And Brophy's the number one player at Alvernia. Kutztown, Nolan Perugini just graduated, but Nolan's number one player there. And he was all conference in doubles.
Absolutely.
Which is outstanding. And Jasmine just graduated.
Jasmine Malik, yep. Played number one there for last year for Sherry.
And then we have Catherine Mayer over there also, and I think we have a Brianna Wendley.
We have Brianna Wendley and Catherine Mayer. You got Kurt Abel.
Kurt
Weiser
Abel.
Playing dubs for the Golden Bears.
And while I've got a chance, I want to thank Sherry over there for having us, the Alvernia men, over to play a practice match with Kutztown. Had a great time there.
And you can't forget, I know we're a little short here on time, we got to get to the women's list, but you got some more players. You got Nick Bellassi and Justin Schutz at LVC.
That's right. We've got the Diego Olagoste, we got Nick Weber at Penn State Berks.
And it's kind of, because you think the depth of it is so far, but you still got Sammy Snyder at Lafayette, you got Allie in her senior year at LaSalle, and the recently graduated Andre Fick. And you got Lynn Robertson at Loyola, and you still have Danny Trefoy, who took a redshirt year this year and is going to come back for a fifth year.
Is he really?
Next year, Thomas Jefferson. So some high-level tennis.
Jack Leinbach starting at York.
So some great kids coming out of Berks and making an impact on the college level.
And Brian Ward on the Lebanon Valley team.
There you go. Just about 4 minutes left here in the show. We got our women top 10 players of the decade on the WTAN. We're going to go here, Hutch. Just a word or two about each of these women as we go through here. 4 minutes left. Number 10, again, a player that really made an impact last decade, has consistently done some things this year, or this decade, was suspended for almost a year with a doping scandal, has come back, and it's been mediocre with her return, and that's Maria Sharapova.
Yeah, Sharapova, probably one of the more recognized faces any place on television, both for tennis and for her advertising. She probably passed her prime a little bit. She can knock off anybody on a hard court.
Earlier in the decade, a tough player. Number one player in the world earlier in the decade.
Yeah. She, and good for her for coming back.
Yep.
And cleaning herself up.
Number nine, recent end of the decade, Naomi Osaka. Back-to-back majors, U.S. Open and Australian Open the end of last year.
Yeah, Osaka, interesting story. Great kid, had that unusual final at the U.S. Open with Serena, crying and all the other stuff that goes on there, the court. Two tall women. Sharapova, almost 6 feet.
Yep.
Osaka, you don't realize she's like 5'10", 5'11".
A big girl.
She's a big girl. These are big women out there playing. And exciting to watch. They hit the heck out of the ball.
Number eight. We have the Belgian, and she's back for 2020. And I thought she might have been higher in the list, but Kim Clijsters. Multiple-time Grand Slam champion, number one in the world, had kids, retired, and she's coming back for 2020.
I kind of saw that, and good for Kim. She married, I think, a basketball player from Villanova, I believe.
Mm-hmm. So I think it's Brian Lynch, I believe is who it is.
Yeah, I think it is. So if we ever want to get somebody around here, maybe we have a shot of getting her sometime. Yeah. What a fun person to watch play. She smiled a lot, she laughed a lot, she hit the heck out of the ball. Strong lady, really good competitor. Really tough to ever root against her.
Number seven, and maybe a little high on this list, I don't know. Won a Grand Slam, Lina.
Lina, best player ever out of China.
Yep.
Another really cool lady. She's coming out of China, communist China. She got out of there. Yep. I think she kept a lot of her proceeds. Yeah, pretty cool player. Big girl again.
Yeah. Number six, somebody that's retiring, end of the Australian Open, next major, Caroline Wozniacki.
Wozniacki, class act again, one of Serena Williams' best friends. Great defender. Probably never had much offense, but won her one Grand Slam.
Yep, absolutely. Number five, we have Victoria Azarenka. Somebody, again, took a little hiatus in the middle of the decade, but number one player, multiple-time Grand Slam winner.
Yeah, and another big, strong girl on the grass, on fast courts. She's unbelievable. These girls are big and strong. If you ever watch them in person, you won't believe how hard they
are. And if you talk about big, strong girls, that gets us to number four, another one, Petra Kvitova.
Yeah. And these girls, if you ever walk next to them, these are big, strong girls. They hit the heck out of the ball.
And she has two Wimbledon titles to her name.
Yeah, as much as I enjoy playing tennis and I don't mind hard hitters, these girls are probably going to hit the ball a little too hard for me.
Number three. And again, did her damage more at the end of the decade. Multiple-time Grand Slam winner from Germany, Angelique Kerber.
Angelique Kerber, she is really an incredible defender, incredible wheels. Probably doesn't have an awful lot of offense on either side, but defense is unbelievable.
She makes you play.
She makes you hit another ball all the time.
Number two, and this player just had a was waiting multiple finals throughout years and years, and finally broke through at the end of the decade. Took a French title, a Wimbledon title this past year, and that's Simona Halep, the best player to ever come out of Romania.
Simona Halep, yeah, really good on both sides. Doesn't mind power at all. She can create angles. She's a real good competitor. Tough lady.
And I think this one, yeah, everybody knows this one's the icing on the cake. No debate here. The number one women's player of the decade, 12 singles majors, 236 weeks at number one, an Olympic gold medal, and coming within three sets of attaining the calendar Grand Slam, losing to Roberta Vinci in 2017, and that's Serena Williams.
Yeah, Serena, best serve period, maybe ever, except for Sampras. Their serves are almost identical. There's no weakness, strength. She really presents wonderful tennis all the time.
And the last fact before we get out of here that I just find amazing. Between the summers of 2012 and 2015, she was 8-0 in Grand Slam finals, had not been beaten in those 4 years in the finals.
That's not bad.
And probably maybe the greatest women's player of all time.
Now she's a mom, and I think her number one priorities are over here. Tennis has probably taken a second step.
She's right there, still pushing, looking for that next major, and she might get it.
Good for her.
We got to get out of here, folks. Hopefully you enjoyed the show today. Our number one, our list of top 10 men's and women's players. And we're going to be back here January 6th for a new decade, a new year. So for Don Hutchinson, I'm Ryan Knarr. We'll see you next time on Berks County Tennis Talk here on BCTV.
Berks County Tennis Talk on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Tennis Association.